to stop it is because there is some other program. So skills education is another important component that was brought about in the 5-year program. Then you have multiple objects of policy development, of lawyering to achieve social engineering, law reform and things like that, and the idea of independent law universities. These were the 5 or 6 components of the vision of the National Law School movement in the late 1980s. And then came the later stage, that is the current stage of legal education, where the vision with which we have started is still relevant, but it requires much more thinking. What are they? It was in a current stage that we, when Manmohan Singh has brought in the economic liberalization, the whole context changed. The WTO came into being and trade in legal services became a possibility. Again, the context got changed. The information communication technology revolution made things so different that one can make a contract from here telephonically or by electronic devices. So therefore, we wanted to have a fresh vision in the late 1990s or early this century. Which vision is yet to be articulated? A few years ago, when Mr. Veerappa Moily was the law minister, he brought in a national consultation with judges and law teachers and others, what he called the third generation law education, which is needed in contemporary times. 3 or 4 things which need to be, because I am not now involved in developing this, but those of you who have some clout, or including students who can think of it and contribute to this change. Number one, the changes in legal practice. Today there is no one single legal profession. There is a legal profession which is litigating. There is a legal profession which is advising business, corporate counsel, which is looking into mergers and acquisitions, which is looking into various other negotiation of technology transfer, writing patent applications, this, that and the other. So therefore, corporate counsel. Then there are LPOs, people who are making a living out of legal process outsourcing, a very big category. Then you have the academics, legal academic profession. You may have ADR, the mediators, the arbitrators, and other people who never go to court but settle disputes in different places. They have become, in other words, legal practice today is of different dimensions, using different skills, having different ground rules for their performance. You will find increasingly in India in the next decade or two, less and less lawyers will be going for litigation. And more law trained people will be doing corporate legal advice, negotiation and transaction. They are called transaction lawyers. People who will be doing mediation and arbitration. People who have nothing to do with court. And as in America today, nearly 90% of American lawyers never appear in court. Only 10% appear in court. We started off with 100% appearing in court and nothing but the court. And today it is slowing down and lawyers' work is being absorbed in government offices, corporate offices and in other areas, including perhaps the panchayats. So change in nature of legal practice and how legal education should respond must get into your vision. Second, need for specialization. The old times, there was one lawyer who would take a matrimonial case, a taxation case, a property transfer property case, everything he can do. Today it's impossible. World has changed. You have to necessarily be specializing in particular areas of legal practice, whether at the trial stage or at the appellate stage. That's why the constitutional lawyers hardly go for any other litigation. Today there are areas in which what you call the regulatory systems, the telecom regulatory authority, which has quasi-judicial powers. The people who appear before that are technology experts. They are lawyers who have studied how the telecom system is functioning. Otherwise, they can't argue there. Gas regulatory authority, electricity regulatory authority, more and more independent judicial systems, legal systems with independent jurisprudence is developing. This is an area for specialists. And those systems, unlike the court, regular court, bring in multiple disciplines. You have to have accountants, you have to have managers, you have to have chemistry experts, management experts. All their expertise will have to bear on solving a problem before the telecom regulatory authority or space regulatory authority. So therefore, the specialization and multidisciplinarity for legal practice is becoming a necessity for the future. A third situation, which is a negative aspect, I would say. Luckily, you know, I just went to meet a group of students of the schools of Bhopal, 10th standard, 11th standard, 12th standard students who are aspiring to write the CLAT examination to get into the National Law School. So when I was interacting with them, they were having all hopes and dreams and things like that and have no idea as to what legal education will be like, legal profession will be like. I told them I cannot also dream as to what it would be like, but I know the trends, some of the trends. What is implied in this is highly talented students who would have walked into a medical college or an engineering college are refusing to go there and apply to the law school. This is a revolutionary change, unthinkable during my days. So when such bright students are coming to the law college, I must admit we have mediocre teachers. Many of them are not able to work on a computer or an internet. They have very little soft skills. They do not read up to date the judgments and update their knowledge. And they try to teach with what they learned 10 years ago, 15 years ago in their LLB, LLM days. World has changed. So that is why the Prime Minister of the country the other day said that legal education in India is a sea, an ocean of mediocrity with some islands of excellence. So this is something to be addressed in your vision plan for the future. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, the disconnect between the constitution and legal education objectives will have to be addressed if we have to survive. If law has to remain relevant, otherwise people will say that let us not have lawyers. As Shakespeare said, let us kill all lawyers. That day is not too far if the legal profession is unable to deliver justice to the millions of rural countrymen of our country who after 65 years are still not able to access justice. Therefore, the vision that we have to construct for the future on legal education, we'll have to have all these things. I will very quickly, in telegraphic language, will tell you some of the components of that vision. One, law education will have to move from legal education to justice education. I have no time to describe this, but I have written extensively on that. As doctors are concerned with health rather than disease, lawyers have to be concerned with justice rather than misfits. If that attitude were to change, then we have to have the nomenclature of law education as justice education. Then we will be changing our mindset, our value system. Our connection with the goals of the Constitution will become very clear. The curriculum will assume different dimensions. That is what is to happen. Second, I would like to tell you that the adversarial legalism that we have borrowed from England, advocate for the plaintiff, advocate for the defendant, the plaintiff's advocate saying, well, my lord, these are the facts, the defendant's advocate denying everything that he has said, and then the prolonged trial of that in an adversarial manner, which leaves these two people to fight and become pauper, because whatever money they have, it has gone to the advocate's pocket. That sort of adversarial litigation, people have learned the game. So therefore he said, let us have Lokadala. Let us settle it. Even Khap Panchayat is better than what is happening in some of the courts. So therefore, people are fed up. Moneyed people can play the game. Some they will buy some time, some stay, some lawyers are engaged only for purchasing stay. I use the word purchasing, quoting from Mamata Banerjee. So anyway, the question that the legal system and the judicial system cannot continue for long in the way it is operating is clear from the discontent among the people. Therefore, that is, adversarial adjudication is not part of Indian ethos. We were traditionally settling dispute by conciliation, by mediation, by elders. That tradition will have to occupy center stage. There are certain complex economic business litigation which need adversarial litigation. But even businessmen do not want adversarial. They want quick settlement, even if it costs some money. But our lawyers are refusing. If quick settlements through mediation is canvassed and legal education is directed to that, the Bar Council of India will call for a strike. What do you do? That's the problem. Number two, diversification of legal profession, legal practice, and naturally legal education. National Law School cannot be taken as a model anymore. If I were to start a National Law School afresh, I will not look at what has been done by me either at Bangalore or Calcutta. They have become outdated. 25 years is too long a period. But unfortunately, still people are replicating the same experience, same curriculum. I do not know why. Vision is lacking. Three, transnational legal practice and trade in legal services is going to come. Bar Council may delay it, but it is bound to come. Your investors, Indian investors in China, they are seeking legal advice, what should be taken care of before I deposit my so many million or billion in China. Indian businessmen have told me that they have to go to England and engage legal services from England to tell them how they must do trading with neighboring China. Because we don't teach Chinese legal system. We don't teach any other legal system other than the English given Anglo-Saxon legal system. So the government of India engages British law firms to give them advice about negotiation with other countries because the legal profession in India is lacking the professional competence. So therefore, the law curriculum will have to prepare themselves for the day trading of legal services where Indian lawyers can set up their practice anywhere in the world where they want to, but knowing the legal system of that country. So that is an important development for the future. Science and technology will occupy the core space in the law curriculum. Today it is patent law, today it is space law, today it is medical law, it is cyber law, but tomorrow you will find earth sciences, biosciences, life sciences, marine sciences, all the sciences will be the basic menu of legal disputation. And if you are not comfortable with those scientific developments, you will be a poor lawyer. Remember, I warn many of you, I have been to IIT Kharagpur. There is a law school. Law school started in IIT Kharagpur and is being planned in IIT Kanpur also, IIT Delhi also, where they admit only B.Tech and B.E. engineers. 50 of them are studying LLB. You know what? When they pass out and take to law, they don't want to go to engineering, but to law. They will monopolize the entire intellectual property practice. They have sound understanding of the state of technology. They will be able to write a patent application much better than a conventional lawyer does. They will be able to present their arguments before the telecom regulatory authority because of their technology skills much better than K.K. Venugopal or Pali Nariman. Therefore, the days are numbered for the National Law School students. You will find it happening in other professional institutions as well, unless you prepare science technology related courses and develop your professional competence. A fourth thing is research, almost nil, even in National Law School. Students are doing some research, but not enough. If you want to improve the quality, naturally you have to innovate, experiment, and that is what research is all about. And that too, cutting edge research. And research which can help the parliament, the government of India, to develop appropriate policies, appropriate institutions. I am presently chairing a committee on a national water law. Water is becoming scarce. And we do not know what should be the policy. We have a national water policy. But what sort of a framework law can be developed is what is being looked into with the help of few lawyers, economists, hydrologists, experts in the Water Resources Ministry. So science is going to be core in research, in quality development and future lawyering. My conclusions, whether one likes it or not, legal education will be different in content and concerns in the next few years. In constructing the vision for the future, one would like to raise some questions on the very objects of legal education in the country. Is legal education intended to produce only litigation lawyers? Even if that was the objective in 1961, when the Advocates Act was enacted, can it continue to be the main focus of legal education in the 21st century? How does such a system address the constitutional goals of eradication of poverty, inequalities in status and opportunities, justice to all, social, economic, political, corruption-free system of governance? How come the country, traditionally known for its conciliation style of dispute resolution, lacks trained mediators, conciliators and arbitrators who can help the ordinary people, the Aam Aadmi, to get justice? Why is it that the legal profession is indifferent to the Grameen Nyayalayas, to the children's courts, and even to Lok Adalat style of dispute resolution? How come legal services are concentrated in urban towns, around the forts, in the vast areas of the countryside with unmet legal needs, where khap panchayats and mafia gangs prevail? Why is it that in law reform and good governance, professional bodies like the bar associations and the bar councils are disinterested? Lokpal will be led by Anna Hazare or Arvind Kejriwal, but the bar leaders have no role. How come? And failed to give leadership as they did during the freedom movement. No doubt there is indeed a disconnect between the constitutional vision and the objectives of organized legal education. This disconnect is accentuated by the language of the law, which Justice Dharma Adhikari referred to, the technicalities of procedure in an adversarial model, and the inordinate delay and excessive cost of litigation. Look that from the perspective of the common man, the legal and judicial system has failed to deliver what is promised by the Constitution. and the failure, at least partly, has been the result of neglect of legal education and a lack of a vision on the part of legal professionals. The objects are not yet clear, and the structure of legal education substantially remains what the colonial masters have left behind. With people getting themselves aware of the game, there are tensions building up, shaking the very foundations of the Republic and its faith in democracy and rule of law. There is need, this is dangerous for the Bar Council, there is need for a Legal Education Act, independent of the Advocates Act, to clarify the objects, articulate its core commitments, and to provide an appropriate structure to organize it in pursuit of the constitutional vision. There is need to maximize the social relevance of legal education by appropriate changes in the curriculum, in the teaching methods, in the teaching materials. There is need, explosive again to you, there is need for a one-year mandatory rural service under the Legal Service Authority for all law graduates, be they from the National Law School or otherwise, before they can be licensed to practice. There is need for institutionalized pre-service training of those selected for teaching jobs in law colleges with a view to equip them with the skills of pedagogy, curriculum development, research and ethics education. These are matters which the present regulatory arrangement, Bar Council included, can neither comprehend nor execute with efficiency. Hence the need for a Legal Education Act in tune with a constitutional vision comprehending all types of legal education, professional legal education, paralegal education, public legal education, and continuing legal education. I have overdone it. I'm sorry. I wanted to use this occasion because I don't meet people, such talented people from so many law universities and law colleges. So I wanted to place this idea so that you will agitate even after going back. And if you agree with some of these ideas, there are no quick solutions. But if you deliberate on that, maybe we can be on the internet, on email, and develop a program which I should think we must present to Parliament or to the President of India. And you must take the lead. Don't expect Chairman Bar Council to do that. If you take the lead, what did Ambedkar say? Educate, organize, agitate. Good.